And then we have Mr. Alex. Alex is 10 years old, and Alex loves food.
Get another piece if you need it. Ooh. Want a juice?
Yes, please. I want barbecue chips.
He underwent surgery to remove his tonsils and adenoids last year. The hope was that this would help him breathe better while sleeping. However, we are noticing some physical changes in his body. He's getting numbness in his hands and feet, and so we still have some serious concerns going on about what's going on with Alex's health
too.
Hello.
Hey.
Dr. Rubel.
Dr. Rubel, how are you? Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, my friend. So what have we got going on today?
Sometimes my feet get numb and my back hurts. Sometimes my back hurts and my hands kind of... What was that word again? My hands kind of...
He'll tell me, like, his hands, they hurt, but I'm wondering, like, hurt or tingle?
Yeah, they tingle.
So I took a look at Alex's sleep study, and it looks like there were 56 times during the sleep study that he stopped breathing in the middle of the night.
Wow.
And that's a very significant number. It looks like, based on the sleep study, he has what we call central apnea in addition to obstructive apnea.
Apnea itself refers to stopping breathing when you're sleeping in the middle of the night. Central apnea means that the actual reason you stop breathing is because of a problem within the brain or the spinal cord, whereas an obstructive apnea is usually typically from something in the mouth, like tonsils or the tongue.
Something that his original surgery was hoping to improve, the blockage that was happening that was causing him to stop breathing in the middle of the night. But it looks like, in spite of that, that he's continued to have many episodes.
Just 6 months ago, Alex had surgery to remove his tonsils and adenoids. You know, our hope was this was gonna fix everything. However, that has not been the case.
So my diagnosis for Alex is that he has central apnea, most likely caused from brainstem compression.
Obviously, you know, our anatomy is different than average-sized people. The base of our skull, where the brain stem meets the spinal cord, the bone that surrounds that area is always extremely tight.
And so when this happens at the bottom of the skull, this narrowing puts pressure on the brain stem. When we need to breathe, this is what tells our body to take a breath. And so when there's pressure on this area, it malfunctions.
I would recommend getting an MRI of the brain. And what we look at is the spinal fluid as it flows in and out through that hole in the bottom of the skull.
If that compression significantly increases on this new MRI, there's no question we're going to need to go ahead with surgery.
All right, you ready for bed?
Yes.
Yeah, you need me to tuck you in?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We recently saw our neurosurgeon, Dr. Rubel, and we discovered that Alex is suffering from central sleep apnea. Good night, guys.
I love you.
I love you.
Oh, boy.
See you in the morning.
Yeah.
Don't keep him awake.
Okay.
I love you, boy.
Love you.
Central apnea is known as the silent apnea. It's where, while you're sleeping, the brain is not able to tell your body to breathe. I am scared, you know, putting him to bed. So, you know, I'm going in and checking on him, filling his chest, making sure he's breathing. And then naturally, you know, when I leave his room and I'm, you know, I obviously need to go to bed, but I'm nervous and scared that, you know, he's gonna stop breathing.
Exactly like last time.
Yeah. If Alex is to panic, Alex would have to be put under general anesthesia, which is the same thing as when he has surgery. You know, it would be a much more invasive MRI. It's him, you know, potentially being sedated and intubated. I don't want to have to put Alex through that. So my hope is that Alex is going to be able to handle it and be tough and you know, lay still for a little while.
I love you, bud.
I love you, too.
Okay, here comes the noise, Alex. Hold real still, bud.
I'm definitely a little bit nervous, just because I want to make sure that he is able to complete this MRI and, you know, so we don't have to come back.
I want you to hold your head nice and still for me, okay, until I tell you to move. You good? All right, he's a rock star.
Thank you. Fabulous. When Alex finished the MRI, I was ecstatic. I really was. I was like, thank you, Jesus, because I knew we were not gonna have to come back for another MRI. He was not gonna have to be sedated.
Well done, bud.
Even though I'm so worried about Alex, it's important for me to keep a happy face on and be strong, because I don't want, you know, Alex to see that I'm, you know, scared and nervous for what's going on. I want him to see that I'm so happy that he got through this hour laying so still. Oh, back to Rubel's office. Hello?
May I speak to Amber Johnson, please?
This is her.
Hi, Amber, this is Christy with Dr. Rubel's office.
Uh-huh. Alex's neurosurgeon, Dr. Rubel's office, calls, and I immediately have this sinking feeling.
I am just calling to follow up with you to let you know where we are with Alex. Dr. Rubel got the results of his MRI back.
This is major, because I'm about to find out if Alex is going to have surgery.
And right now the MRI is showing some compression. Dr. Rubel's recommendation is that we do the decompression surgery.
Oh, wow. Okay. He also felt like, you know, we needed to do it sooner than later.
I will have someone from scheduling reach out to you later today.
Thank you. And so he had an opening for, you know, next week. Hey, Trent.
Yeah.
Come here. I know that when they are fast tracking things like this, it's pretty serious. That was Dr. Rubel's office, and he, it was his nurse, and she said that he read the MRI results, and he said that we need to, definitely feels that we need to move forward with surgery. She said that Dr. Rubel has an opening in like a week away, or a little less than a week away.
From now?
Yeah.
Good gracious. That just tells us how severe the case is. The amount of compression that Alex has going on, for Dr. Rubel to want to move forward this fast.